And after worship, I'm going to be sitting among the Valentines. I am looking for 11 people to make dinner for Oasis this semester. It's real easy. All you have to do is make a casserole, you know, put together a salad, make a batch of brownies, and that's it. If you're interested in providing food for the college students on Wednesday evenings, please see me. I have a sign-up list and an instructions sheet. Thank you.
As you are aware, February 14th is Valentine's Day. What you might not be aware of is this year, February 14th is Ash Wednesday. So we are in need of people to serve as ushers for the Ash Wednesday service. If this is something you can and would like to do, please see me after the service. Thank you.
Let us stand and greet one another.
Standing, if you are able, and join me in the call to worship projected on the screens in front of you or printed in your bulletin. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad.
With what shall we come before the Holy One and bow ourselves before God on high?
God has shown us what is good.
And what does the Holy One require of us?
To do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with our God.
excuse me. The proof of God's amazing love is this. While we were sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in him, we dare to approach God with confidence. In faith and penitence, let us confess our sin before God and one another. O gracious and gentle God, God of peace, source of mercy and comfort, we confess before you the evil of our hearts. We acknowledge that we are too inclined toward feelings of anger, jealousy, and revenge, which often give rise to bitterness between us and others. Forgive us our sin, and permit us to partake of the blessing you have promised the peacemakers, who shall be called the children of God. And all God's people say, words of assurance. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love toward us.
In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Glory be to God. Amen.
As God's own people, be merciful in action, kindly in heart, humble in mind. Be always ready to forgive as freely as God has forgiven you. And, above everything else, be loving and never forget to be thankful for what Christ has done for you.
Sometimes I think, what would people say of me when I'm only just a memory, when I'm home where my heart belongs? Was I love when no one else would show up? Was I Jesus to the least of those? Was my worship more than just a song? I want to live like them and give it all I have, so that everything I say and do points to you. If love is who I am, then this is where I'll stand. Oh,
Could we have the children come forward for the children's message? Waiting for one and maybe two. Yep, here comes one. All right. Yeah, good. Cooper's coming. That's great. Okay. All right. Now, today there's this big football game. And when you watch a football game or you watch a race with people running, or you watch a baseball player run down at first base, when that ball player gets to first base, or the halfback runs all the way and gets a touchdown, or the race runner completes a mile, what do you see at the end of that usually? Well, what you see is a person bent over going, man, am I tired. And it happens to us too. If you're outside on the playground at recess running around like crazy, or in the gym when it's too cold to get outside, and you're running around playing tag or whatever you play, you get tired. And you take a deep breath and you think, man, I am tired. And let me tell you something. When you get older, you get tireder. You don't run as much either. Okay. Well, today's Bible passage, one of them, is from the prophet Isaiah. And Isaiah was one of the men that brought God's word to the people of Israel. And Isaiah says, okay, here's a message. God is the creator of the ends of the earth. God does not grow faint or get tired. Not only that, God gives power to the faint. And to someone without any might or strength, God gives strength. Even young people like you will faint and be weary. You get tired from all your exercise. Young men shall fall exhausted. But people who wait for the Lord or depend on God, they will renew their strength. They'll mount up their wings, like eagles. You ever see eagles flying or big birds flying? They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And God is always there to help us with that. So next time you're running around going, man, I can't do this anymore because I am just too tired. Just remember, when you get tired of other things too, God's always there to help. Okay? All right. Quick prayer. God, we thank you that you give us strength. Strength to do what we need to do every day. We thank you for your love for us, which is why you do that. Help us to be friends with each other and to help each other. In your name we pray. Amen.
Let us unite in the prayer for illumination. Almighty God, you have spoken to us through your Son. Let your written word now be spoken and heard by each of us. Give us ears to hear and hearts to understand, that we may not refuse your calling or ignore your voice. Amen. Today's Old Testament lesson comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, verses 21 through 31. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown. Scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth, when he blows upon them, and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name. Because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with the wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Our response is Psalm 147. We will read it responsively either from the screens or from your bulletin. Praise the Lord. How good it is to sing praises to our God, for he is gracious, and a song of praise is fitting. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. Great is our Lord, and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make melody to our God on the lyre. He gives to the animals their food, and to the young ravens when they cry. But the Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him, in those who hope in his steadfast love. He has not dealt thus with any other nation. They do not know his ordinances. Praise the Lord.
Turning to the New Testament, we read from 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 16 through 23. The Apostle Paul addresses the church at Corinth and writes, "If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward, but if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews I became as a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. And then from the Gospel of Mark, we read from chapter 1, verses 29 to 39. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." And he answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." He went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The word of the Lord. If you have a prayer request, we ask that you hold up your prayer request card during the singing of our next hymn so that the ushers may collect.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, be with us this day as we come to your word. Make us aware of your call and claim upon our life. Help us be eager to see those chances to say your word to the world. And may we know of your guiding hand upon history. And may we know about your guiding hand on our life. It is in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Last night I was at the Egyptian Theater and got to play in a concert that featured four different big bands. Jazz in Progress played first, and then Sycamore, and then DeKalb, and then the NIU Jazz Band. And I was just a person filled with gratitude that night because we got to go first, and the rest of those bands blew us away. Holy cow, they were good. I don't know if you go to the Sycamore or the DeKalb High School Jazz Band concerts, but you should. Wow, they are just outstanding groups. And that little bit of good fortune was a reminder of those little bits of providence that may come our way. That little chance not to have to follow somebody that's way better than you. That little chance just to be part of making some great music. That was such a gift, and it was so much fun. There are little chances that come our way. There are those times when we experience just a glimmer of grace in the midst of our everyday life. When we look up and we say how lucky we are to be children of God and to know that God has touched us in a particular way. We look at our family and are just kind of amazed at the way their goodness or their kindness has shown up and the way they live their life, the way they picked up what it meant to be faithful. We look at the people we love, maybe look at a spouse or a close friend, and we say thank you to God for the traits of this person. Sometimes we are so fortunate, you know, just to get the parking space. Lord, thank you. Thank you for that. How good is that, just to have that little touch of goodness come to us? And I think if we look, if we open our eyes to the fact that God is at work in us and in the world, there are all kinds of those little things that we see, all kinds of places where we know that God's hand has touched us. And that's part of what we encounter in this text today. This text that comes in the book of Isaiah at a pivotal time in the history of Israel. So Israel has completely fallen apart. All their leadership has been carted away to Babylon. The temple has stopped being the temple. The land has stopped being the promised land. There are no kings on the throne anymore. And this mess is what these people find themselves in Babylon. And they start asking themselves, how is it that God is still at work in the midst of the mess? And in chapter 40, we have both the big answer and the little answer that remind us of how God is at work in the world. And there is that big answer in which God stands above everything and we all look like grasshoppers. stars, to use the language of the text. How about that? We are just tiny little bugs in the great scheme of things, and yet God is over it all. And that's a promise that's given to us. Many times it's hard to see, and we have become aware of the profound evil that is in the world. Profound. And we listen to a history that is pleasing to our ear because it's maybe written for us or written by us, and it sort of ignores the profound destruction, perhaps, that, say, well, just conquering America took. I mean, the disease and the devastation and the death that affected those people that were already here as other people moved across the country to the West. It's just a difficult story to listen to and comprehend. You know, it's great to put the winner's name as being the ones touched by God's hand in all this, but that's not how it works. I mean, there's awful things that go on in the world, and certainly that last century in which we start numbering our wars by Roman numerals, and which we look at a time in which the United States has been nearly continuously engaged in war over the course of a century. You just know how difficult it is. It's a hard world out there. And for us to acknowledge that somehow God is over it all is always a statement of faith and an act of faith, and yet a truth that comes back to us again and again in the course of Scripture. There is one who is over it all. And we should not forget the big guiding hand in the picture of our lives. And yet, we sometimes understand the big truth in the midst of the small truths. And so the small truths come to us again and again in just the way we find energy when we thought we had none. When we discover in the midst of the community of faith a healing touch when we didn't even know we needed to be healed. It has been suggested that the difference between sort of the evangelical church and sort of mainline churches is that in some churches they are looking for a moment of conversion, that moment in which you turn and see things in a clear light. And you know you've been touched by God's hand because all the things that went on before do not seem as important as this one experience. And those can be profound moments, and many of you have had moments like that in which God suddenly wakes you up and says, you are mine and I am laying a claim upon you. And then in mainline churches, sometimes the better way to understand that is that God keeps giving us moments like that. Moments in which not only do we have a sudden turning, but sometimes the turning is very slow. And we discover that maybe that anger we had nourished for a lifetime is something we can let go. Maybe that prejudice that has been ingrained into us, that hurt or that distance that we have experienced because we think others see us as different, well, we can let that go. And this kind of personal healing that goes on and on over time is best experienced in community, not just a community that says, yes, you are my friend, but somehow there is love between each of us and love in the midst of us. And that transforming power, well, that isn't just a one-time thing. It just goes on and on. It's something that keeps being given to us over the course of life. We're never done with the business of salvation. But God's salvation is continuing to work itself into our lives and in our hearts. And that's where we come to one of the great personal stories in the gospel. We have that picture of God's transcendence given to us by that great image out of the book of Isaiah. But in today's gospel reading, we have a much more intimate picture. Jesus leaves the synagogue with the disciples. They enter the house of Simon and Andrew. He's there with James and John. Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. Not even a little time off. She's been sick, Jesus heals her, and she goes right back to work. We are being healed to go right back to work. And this call isn't a call that's far off or far away, but it comes in the service that shows up in our lives, in the kindness of our hearts, in the ways we are able to speak to another person that may need that word of kindness or comfort, or speak a big word to a culture that seems bent on consumerism and militarism and racism and sexism and ageism, and say to this culture that cannot often see beyond consuming and acquiring, and say there's another point to your life. Take a look at what God would have you do. How is it you are going to serve? After Jesus goes about his work there in Capernaum, it says he goes to a deserted place, and there he prayed. If you're ever on the shores of the Sea of Galilee, you discover there were towns all around where Jesus was in ministry. And this deserted place was like 200 yards from the nearest place. I mean, he did not go far away. They didn't have trouble finding him. He got what peace he could, and he was immediately interrupted. Parents out there had that experience. You know, you finally get 20 minutes, and no, they're the kids. They're right back at you again. Well, in the midst of it all, Jesus finds a way to go out and serve again, relying on the same gifts that have been given to each of us, in the power of the Spirit that unites us as God's people, and the power of the Spirit that animates us for faithful life. He finds a way to step out and say again that thing that he has been called to do. Don't forget the word you've heard. In Jesus, we have seen what God's about in particular. And the one who is transcendent is also the one who is immanent, is also the one who is transcendent. And in the midst of the big and small of life, may we look for the God who never gives up on us, but seeks us out. To God be the glory. Amen. Let us stand and affirm our faith. God, our Creator, calls Westminster Presbyterian Church to share Christ's transforming love. We strive to be the hands and feet of Jesus Christ through worship, prayer, learning, service, and fellowship. Inspired by the Holy Spirit, we seek to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with God. You may be seated. Um, Many of you noticed that earlier I got flummoxed when I was having mic troubles and left out an important announcement, which is today, immediately after church, do not leave the sanctuary if you are a member, because we have a congregational meeting for the purpose of electing a replacement for Terry Dugan. He moved to Cleveland and he quit coming to meetings. I don't understand it. So we have got a replacement. And we are going to hear the report of the nominating committee, and then we'll be done. And we'll have donuts, well, donut holes, and coffee out there. So immediately after worship, stay put, please. As we come to our prayers today, we remember the rose that honors the birth of Lindsay Simo. She was born last week. She is doing fine, and we pray for the grateful parents. We have this prayer request from Ann and James Tucker. Ann's celebrating my parents' 70th wedding anniversary on February 8th. Bless our family as we travel to Arizona to be together. And this request for a premature baby who was born at 23 weeks to a relative. We also want to pray for Morley Russell. He had to be hospitalized this past week and should be home now, recovering from respiratory struggles. With these concerns in mind, let's come to God in prayer. Let us pray. We praise and thank you, O Lord, that you have fed us with your word. We are grateful for your gifts and mindful of our connection with all the faithful everywhere. We offer to you our prayers for all people. God of compassion, we remember before you the poor, the afflicted, the sick, and the dying, those who are in prison, those who are lonely, the victims of war, injustice, and inhumanity, and all others who suffer from whatever their sufferings may be called. O Lord of Providence, holding the destiny of the nations in your hand, we pray for our country. Inspire the hearts and minds of our leaders that they, together with all of our nation, may first seek your kingdom and righteousness, so that order, liberty, and peace may dwell with your people. O God, our Creator, we pray for all nations and peoples. Take away the mistrust and lack of understanding that divide your creatures. Increase in us the recognition that we are all your children. O Savior God, look upon your church in its struggle upon the earth. Have mercy on its weakness. Bring to an end its unhappy divisions and scatter its fears. Look also upon the ministry of your church, increase its courage, strengthen its faith, and inspire its witness to all people, even to the ends of the earth. Author of grace, God of love, send your Spirit's blessing upon your children here gathered. Keep our hearts and thoughts in Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior, who has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us offer our gifts to God.
Let us pray. O God, the fountain of all good, we bring to you our gifts as you have prospered us. Enable us with our earthly things to give you the love of our heart and the service of our lives. Let thy favor, which is life, and thy loving kindness, which is better than life, be upon us now and always, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our hearts was all.
And now go in peace. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit abide with each one of you from this time forth and forevermore. And all God's people say,
Amen.
You may be seated. Sit. We have a congregational meeting for the purpose of replacing Terry Dugan on the church facility board. And did we get a replacement for auditor, too? We did. Okay, that's great to hear. So with that in mind, let us pray. Gracious God, we give thanks for those you call to service. And we give thanks for those who serve faithfully and who found new ministries. Bless our efforts this day. Bless the people we elect. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Do we have a representative from the nominating committee who wants to talk? Okay, Marie? Yeah.
The Internal Audit Committee, we are replacing Terry Dugan. We are nominating Tony Kroll.
All right. Are there nominations from the floor? This is a congregational office of auditor, and they just look through our financial records. Okay. Let us handle the let us go ahead and vote on the auditor. If there are no nominations from the floor, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, the motion's carried. Nominating committee.
For the church facilities board, we are nominating Jim Tucker.
All right, Tucker's name has been placed in nomination for the church facility board. Are there nominations from the floor? Hearing none, are you ready to vote? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, the motion's carried. This concludes the business for which this meeting has been called. Motion to adjourn. It's been seconded. All those in favor, please rise.